Today's episode has been brought to you by
Schedule C.
Welcome to episode 56 of the Connected Yoga Teacher Podcast with today's guest, Leslie Kazadi, certified yoga therapist and yoga teacher for over 17 years. After a motorcycle accident, Leslie began to truly understand the depth of healing and transformation that yoga offered in both her body and her life. Leslie has worked with adults of all ages with various complex medical conditions, and today she talks to us about yoga and menopause. Thanks for being here. I'm your host, Shannon Crow, a mother of three, a yoga teacher, and a consultant for yoga teachers who want to create a sustainable yoga business that lights them up. Over the years in teacher trainings and through the consulting work that I do, yoga teachers have told me that they feel disconnected and alone in the wilderness of yoga entrepreneurship. I get it, and I have also felt this way. This sparked the Connected Yoga Teacher Podcast, a place where you can feel supported and connected every week between the classes, workshops, and trainings that you are teaching or attending. Together, we hear from yoga teachers and other professionals who share information, ideas, stories, and actionable steps. If you are wanting to meet up in person, there are a few ways to do that. The easiest one is to go to our homepage, theconnectedyogateacher.com, take a look at our map, and see who is in your area of our Connected Yoga Teacher community. If you're not already on the map, feel free to add yourself there. Also, there are a couple of teacher trainings that I am leading this spring. First is Mama Nurture, the RPYT, or Registered Prenatal Yoga Teacher Training in Meaford, Ontario, over 3 weekends. That starts in April, so it's soon. Also, Yoga for Pelvic Health is also in Meaford at Beth Ruddy's studio. And I just printed off my tickets to attend the Accessible Yoga Conference in Toronto. Super excited about this. It's the first ever conference like this, and it's June 22nd to 24th. I can put a link in the show notes, and I know a bunch of us are planning on getting together there. Three of our podcast guests are actually speakers at the conference, and so it'll be fun just to connect and gather. If you can't travel to meet up with someone, you can meet up with us virtually in our Facebook group. It's for yoga teachers or for those who are in a yoga teacher training right now. And I wanted to share a couple of posts that are new this week. So Jolene, thank you so much for posting a great question in the Connected Yoga Teacher Facebook group. Jolene wrote, "I love yoga workshops and special classes. What have you guys done in the past? What do you have coming up? What is your price point?" So there are some amazing offerings in this thread. If you want to find that thread, I'll put a link to it in our show notes, and you can share an event, a training, a retreat, or a workshop, and also look at some other ones there. You might find ideas, and it's great to find out what other yoga teachers are offering. Lori also posted a question that many of you liked and commented on. She asked, "What are your favorite yoga or fitness clothing brands that are not the modernized Lululemons or Athletas of the world?" Surely there's someone out there offering more traditional, loose, non-fashion focused yoga clothes. Also, I heard that some companies offer discounts to teachers in hopes that you'll act as a real life model for them. Is that true? This part of the post can include the Lululemons and Athletas of the world. So thank you so much for this, Lori. So many people posted where they love to buy their clothing that they wear for yoga and really weighed in on how they feel about just the clothing that we wear as yoga teachers. So again, you can find the link for that in the show notes, which will take you back directly to that thread. And there you can read what other people posted and share your own comments. Before we dive in and meet Leslie today, let's hear from our sponsor, Schedule a City.
Connected Yoga Teachers. This is Shayna with the Schedulicity Hot Tip of the Week. We've talked a lot about how Schedulicity can save you tons of time as a teacher, but what about your clients? The inspiration to take a yoga class can hit anytime, anywhere. Actually, being able to put your name on the list for a class takes that whim and turns it into a commitment. So if your next student realizes they need to get limber and blissed out halfway through a bad blind date, while they're in the middle of a stressful meeting, or at 2 o'clock in the morning, all they need is 15 seconds and Schedulicity. Get booking done in a hot flash.
Thank Thank you so much for that, Shayna. I told Shayna that our topic today was menopause, and I said, I'm not sure how you're going to tie that in with the hot tip, but she's pretty brilliant at writing hot tips, and she did it and made me laugh. Every time I hear it now, I'm laughing. Thank you for that, Schedulicity. In my years of teaching yoga, so many women have approached me at the beginning of a class to come up and to let me know that if they start taking layers of clothing off and sweating and looking hot, it's just that they're experiencing hot flashes. I really love it that they share this with me. But up to this point, I didn't know what to say. Before I talked with Leslie in this interview, I was feeling kind of lost. I haven't experienced menopause yet, and to be really honest, not a lot of women in my circles were talking to me about what their experience is like, other than these women coming up and saying that they were experiencing a hot flash. Studies show that, and I'll put a link to this in the show notes, studies show that yoga and other meditation-based programs offer an improvement to overall menopausal symptoms, symptoms like mood swings, sleep, and musculoskeletal pain. I reached out to Leslie because I wanted to know what a yoga student is dealing with during menopause and how we as yoga teachers can help. Leslie Kazadi is a registered yoga teacher and a certified yoga therapist. She traveled to India and studied both Ashtanga and Iyengar yoga with Patabi Joyce and BKS Iyengar. Her first yoga teacher training was in 2001 at Yoga Works. Leslie took a 2-year program for yoga therapy in 2008 and 2009. She is certified in massage and Thai massage, and her interests in anatomy, kinesiology, and the mind-body-spirit connection are strong. When Leslie was 26, her mother died of breast cancer. To honor her mother, she gave massage in an AIDS hospice. She learned that being present is the greatest healer. Leslie has designed and implemented protocols in physical therapy clinics and for yoga research studies, as well as contributed to articles in peer-reviewed medical journals and research projects. She has a yoga school where she leads 200 and 300-hour yoga teacher trainings. It's called Alchemy Yoga Therapy, and we'll link to that in the show notes as well. Welcome to the Connected Yoga Teacher Podcast, Leslie. It is amazing to have you here today.
I'm so glad to be here.
Tell me first, tell our listeners how you got started. Where did your yoga journey begin?
My personal yoga journey began when I started closed captioning the news for TV. And I promised myself that when I got out of school, I would start taking dance lessons again. I couldn't afford to do anything when I was in school. And then the job was super stressful. So even though I was 30, I started doing yoga for stress relief for myself and then fell in love with it and had an Ashtanga teacher who said, you should be a teacher. And I had a brand new career, and I was like, why would I want to do that? And I thought, well, I'll just take a teacher training and teach yoga to my friends in the park. And it just kind of little by little turned into, you know, really teachers saying, come do this with me and giving me opportunities. And even then, this is 20 years ago almost, I was like, I don't know, there's way too many yoga teachers. I don't know why I'd want to do that, which is hilarious now. But I got really sort of hooked into teaching people who had injuries, and I started teaching people, older adults, and so that just really captured my interest and my attention to teach yoga to people who really don't do yoga or can't do yoga like the way I knew it.
Right. So backing this up, what did you take in school? And you were doing closed captioning, you said?
So I'm a court reporter. And so closed captioning is writing on a court reporting machine, the news, so that people who are hearing impaired, they get the captions along the bottom of the screen.
Okay.
Totally a different thing, except it's absolutely in the moment. Like, doesn't matter what's going on. You just have to keep being present, and you know, you mess up because it's live. And so I had this job where I was sitting at home, not moving, listening and watching the news for a living. Now I don't ever watch the news.
Oh, that's interesting.
Yeah, it's like, you know, somebody does everything kind of thing that you don't really think about. Like, there's somebody sitting at home, you know, writing every word about the Las Vegas over and over again, like that kind of stuff. That was what I did.
Right. So no wonder you had a high stress volume, you know, kind of taking in all of this, you know, everything that's chaotic or negative in the world, it packed into a news program.
Right.
So then you took your first yoga teacher training where?
At Yoga Works, like good old days. There was just, you know, Mati Esrati and Lisa Walford at one, you know, family-owned studio in Santa Monica. How you know, it's so crazy. And that was in 2001.
Okay. And so then what led you more and more to where you are today? Like when you said that you are working, like to work with people who wouldn't typically be in a yoga class, do you know why you were led to that? Or what, like, was there a moment?
I think from the moment I did my teacher training, you know, I started practicing in the back of the room and just so I could, you know, watch the teacher and see how people moved. And I was always drawn to like, what the hell is going on with her shoulder, you know, or like, what is like, that was always the most interesting to me. And I've always been interested just in anatomy. And so I got asked to be part of a yoga study and be the assistant in a research study for older adults. And at that time, there really weren't programs for older adults. There weren't books. There was definitely nothing on the internet about, you know, how do you teach older adults? So I just started getting all of these anatomy books and trying to like figure out like, how can you modify things for people and what happens when people can't move? And then that just became really, part of it was the puzzle that made it interesting for me. And part of it was the reward of really helping people who didn't think that they could do yoga. And older people for sure don't think they can do yoga. And then they're so grateful. And it's really easy to give them a big experience and for them to immediately notice that it feels better, because they, people who don't move much or move well or pay attention to their breathing or have any sort of, you know, stress-reducing device in their life, like they get it way more than sort of the general population, that how much they need it and how good it feels to them. So you get to be really impactful with really simple things.
Wow, that's pretty powerful. I know a lot of yoga teachers working with either people as an older population or people who have mobility issues and the serious ones. And myself, that's the work that I'm drawn to at the physiotherapy office that I work at. And I was very interested because you've done a lot of work with specifically for yoga and yoga for menopause. Can you tell us sort of what got you interested in that?
Yeah, going through it.
Excellent. That's the best experience, really, is to be right in it.
And I, you know, it's so funny because like everybody knows, oh, menopause, hot flashes, or crazy cycles that go on forever, or get really spotty. But you don't really know everything that goes on with men, like anything, until you're in it. And I remember I was teaching a workshop and it was just on structural therapeutics. And I kind of off the cuff said something about there being some positive things with menopause. And I just remember the group, it was like everybody spun their head around and I was like, oh, that's something. Because people don't think there's anything positive about it. And also, you know, the symptoms are so varied. And, you know, these days we go through, well, should you get hormones or should you not get hormones? And we have this expectation of feeling good. And we also don't talk so much about, and especially in LA, like people don't talk about, oh my God, my body's falling apart, or I, you know, I've gained weight and I like the sort of the disappointment of aging. And, you know, and so I feel like, people would sort of quietly talk to me about, gosh, you know, I feel like this is changing and this is happening and no one talks about this and no one really knows about this. Or of course, everyone who's been through menopause, it's like having a baby and people going, wow, nobody told me it was going to be this hard, that, you know, I was going to be this scared, or all these different things. And so I just, you know, there's a website, I think it's either 33 or 34 menopausal symptoms. And, you know, things like heart palpitations and electrical shock sensations in your head. And it's like, am I having a heart attack or am I just going through menopause? And it's, I think, a lot more intense than you realize until you get there. And like so many things, we just don't talk about it. And things that felt good to me in my own practice, like no longer did. And then you start realizing, oh, that there's a lot of women who like loved having a really strong practice. They still want to have a really strong practice, but like all those chaturangas, they don't feel good anymore. And they don't want to do like senior yoga. So that's really recognizing that, oh, there's a real need for people to still have a strong practice. And also, you know, you get older and you start wanting more than just a physical practice. And hopefully, you know, in anything, the more you do it, you're like, wait, there's more to this than just asana. So yeah, that's a little bit, that's a lot, I guess.
It's really insightful though. I appreciate so much that you say that people are not talking to you about it, just in the general sense of, you know, what is menopause? What are the symptoms? I know myself, I have some pretty strong women in my life. There have been a few that have talked about it, but it's not, I have to ask a lot of questions. You know, my mom will answer my questions because people always say, go to your mom and talk to your mom about how her menopause was and find out there, but I'm not really getting a lot of concrete things. So, you know, what are some of the common symptoms then that others deal with? Or I'd like to get into that a little bit more, kind of what was your experience with it? How did you know, okay, this is menopause?
Right. And that's the other thing is people don't know, right? Because perimenopause can be 2 to 10 years. And so, you know, the average time that people go through menopause is 50. And for sure, your mother and your female, you know, your sisters, your aunts are going to be the clearest indicator of what your experience is going to be like. And just when I was 48, had a hysterectomy that I still had my ovaries and my cervix. So I was still getting hormones, and it was so weird to not have a cycle and to still feel that you are ovulating. So I could still feel my cycle, but I just, you know, wasn't having a period. And so that's like the best of all worlds.
Right.
But that's also, you know, so that went on for a couple of years. And then when, you know, once you start having your menstrual cycle, then you kind of stop keeping track of it. So I knew because of that menopause, I'd sort of initiated the process and that it was going to come sooner than later because of that. And also I was right around, you know, at 50 is sort of the normal age that you would expect to get menopause. So, you know, the hysterectomy is of course dramatic, but then, you know, you start getting hot flashes, which is just kind of a hilarious thing. I would not be able to sleep, you know, for like a couple of hours in the night, be like wide awake. And then you have brain fog, and people don't really talk about brain fog. I mean, you talk about, you know, oh, you get older and your brain doesn't work as well. And I was like, well, is this hormones or is this just the fact that I'm not sleeping? And so I feel stupid. So the lack of energy, and again, is the lack of energy, is that the hormones or is that because I'm not sleeping? And is this it? I think that's, you know, when you're going through things and you realize, gosh, you know, like my brain is just like not in gear anymore, and I'm not sleeping as well as I used to anymore. And, you know, like anything, you start thinking, oh my God, is this it? Is this going to always be like this? And you start looking for ways to sleep better, to think better, to have more energy. And so many conversations come about like hormones and diet things and, you know, meditation things and breathing practices and like, what can I do? Because you don't, so that you can feel better. I mean, I think people come to yoga in general to feel better, and we have an expectation that we're going to feel better. For me personally, I had been in a motorcycle accident when I was 46, and I had lots of like tingling and electrical shock things from an injury to my neck. And so again, you're like, God, is that from the accident? Is that getting worse? Is that menopause? Is that something else? Is that going to ever go away? Because the list of symptoms is pretty intense. I don't get heart palpitations, but a lot of people do. And so that's like super scary. I think that people do know, and I hope that people do know, that, you know, when you go through menopause, your risk of heart attack skyrockets, your risk of osteoporosis skyrockets. People get digestive stuff, and especially GERD, acid reflux, which I had no idea about. That's pretty common. And so, you know, I'm like drinking coffee first thing in the morning and then going to a yoga class and you know, being upside down for an hour and a half, and which is like the worst thing you can do if you have GERD. I didn't know what GERD really was, like, not really. My diet's healthy, my life is healthy, but yet, like, why would I have that? But that's a common thing that people go through. And then people, you know, we know, oh, you know, your skin is gonna, like, it's just like you feel like you got old overnight. Like, all of a sudden, your skin is really different. Your muscle tone is really different. People gain weight, and that I think people don't really talk about or accept here. I think there's this like, oh my gosh, you know, especially teachers, you know, we're supposed to be on Instagram and look like we did when we were 30. And I think people have a lot of sadness and shame around the change because of that. There's a lot of grief around being biologically irrelevant. And we don't talk about those kinds of things, just as a society, and you don't really, you know, you don't really think about that until you get there and you're like, oh, wow. Yeah. My place in the world has really shifted and there's not a lot of space.
Right. I really appreciate you bringing light to just what your experience has been and kind of what you feel in that situation. It makes me start to think of, as a yoga teacher, you know, a woman came to my class last week and said, I'm having a lot of hot flashes. So if you see me like stripping my clothes off really quickly or looking all red and flushed, and I was like, no worries. You know, but I don't know if I had the tools to really say something helpful in that moment. I know this from having other students in my class. Can you think of something as a yoga teacher, like this is how you would deal with someone having hot flashes in your class? Is there something not positive to say or something helpful to say?
Yeah, and you know, it's that human connection piece. It's always tricky, especially when you haven't gone through it, because sort of towing that line of I understand, but I haven't really been there. And I think, you know, some of the things is just to know is, you know, I would encourage people to drink water, or if you know, the temperature thing is like the eternal fight in yoga, right? Like I want it cooler, I want it hotter. And so if you know in any room that you teach in, like, oh, it's cooler by this window, or, it's if you know the cool places in the room, like the literal cool temperature zones in the room, that can be helpful. If you ask people if like they know shitali breath or certain things that they can actually do in the moment for themselves, and be mindful just to always, when people come to you with anything, right, you want to say, it's totally fine, do whatever you need to do to take care of yourself. You know, if you happen to be teaching a class that's hot, letting people know it's okay to leave the room or to rest, and just giving people permission to do what they need to do. I think that's what we always want to do as teachers, and let our students teach us. And I think to know that anytime people have a symptom of anything, to know, yeah, that could be menopause. Like, oh, you're having anxiety can be a form or can be a symptom of menopause. And but also always to suggest that anytime somebody's concerned that they see their doctor, that you don't go, oh yeah, that's just this and that's no big deal. Because women, you know, it's sort of like pregnant women too. When your hormones are shifting, you want to feel seen. And I think, you know, women who go through menopause don't feel seen anymore. And so really acknowledging people is one of the biggest things.
What yoga really helped you, or what yoga do you always turn to when you are trying to help a student with menopausal symptoms? You mentioned the shitali breath.
Yeah. And so sleep is a big thing. And I also teach restorative yoga, but like if I can't sleep, then I do a yoga nidra practice. And so I think like if you teach or you just have some resources of, you know, some like guided relaxations or yoga nidra, things to help people so that they can sleep, because they're going to be more likely to come to your class if they're like not exhausted. And also to have some relaxation poses kind of handy for people. Because a lot of times if they want to come to your class. Maybe they're tired and they need to be able to take a break. If people have some like go-to poses to do, so they feel like they're still empowered to be in the class and do their own thing. But I think it's really great if you're teaching people who are in midlife, if you're teaching vinyasa classes, to know some ways to modify them so that people still feel like they're doing the class. You know, like if you do Surya Namaskara C, which is just, you know, on your knees instead of, you know, it's just modifying Chaturanga and those kinds of things. Those are good things for you as a teacher to have in your toolbox. And sometimes you can just teach that as the first vinyasa for everybody. And just finding ways that people feel like they're participating in the class, not being singled out, and yet they're modifying their class so that it feels the right amount for their energy, the right amount for their joints. Having arthritis and pain in the joints is something that happens a lot kind of suddenly in menopause. And so just, you know, taking it easy in the beginning. People may need to build strength in ways they never did before. Like I, you know, before menopause, I was just doing yoga, and that was like plenty for me to feel like really strong. And now I have a strength routine, and I want to be, you know, in poses where I'm holding them longer and even, you know, using resistance, whether that means, you know, holding a block over your head when you're in Warrior One, like those kinds of things to help people maintain their strength.
Right. So there's kind of two sides to this, in that we're still building strength in the body, but then we also tap into, you know, if you're not sleeping, you're welcome to come into class, find a restorative pose, or like you said, the yoga nidra. Do you find that those things help in times of, you know, not being able to sleep?
I absolutely do. And, you know, it's like one of those things when you can't sleep, you don't remember in the moment, like, you know, like, oh, it's 2 o'clock in the morning. Yeah, let me get my yoga nidra tape on. You know what I mean? Like, let me find that on my phone. You start feeling anxious about got to get up at such time in the morning and I'm not sleeping. And you start doing the math. But they absolutely do help. And it's like anything else. It's like getting into a routine. You know, what I did in the moment was I just gave myself permission to give myself an extra hour of sleep, knowing that it wasn't gonna, you know, I just sort of built that into my schedule, and it's temporary. So like all, you know, the hot flashes it's not temporary for everybody. Like there are some people who have hot flashes for the rest of their life. That's a small percentage. That's like super bad news. But for most people, it's temporary. The brain fog is temporary. And again, I'm not sure. And if that's because the hormones stabilize, even if they're at a really different rate, or if it's because you're getting your sleep. But the brain fog isn't going to last forever. None of it lasts forever. And I think that can be really soothing for people. But I mean, I think it's from diet and from having a steady practice and from lots of things. Like, I feel like, oh yeah, I went through a couple of years where I wasn't sleeping great. And regardless practices that I did, sometimes it worked, sometimes it didn't. But giving myself permission to just be in that place and knowing it was temporary was, you know, acceptance, like sort of the radical acceptance for what is, and changing the things that you can, and making peace that life is different, like all of that sort of the yoga philosophy stuff that gets you through the hard stuff, and not fixing everything.
Right. Oh, that's so powerful, really, in terms of, you know, just having this, coming to this place of acceptance and knowing there is an end to this. This brings to mind just a common thing that I see. I see some students who embrace and come into this acceptance and this kind of grace with things. And then I do have students or friends really tell me, like, I'm on a fight with my body, or tell me it with different language, like, I'm going to win against this aging. Can you speak to that at all?
Yeah. Well, I mean, it's so pervasive in our culture, like anti-aging cream, anti-aging this, anti-aging that. And there are a lot anti-aging yoga, like specifically, they just say, you know, the fountain of youth. And it's, you know, and it's interesting. I've had conversations with people about, you know, we're going to obviate aging. We have the technology, which I'm like, well, I don't know if that's really true. And I don't know how much that may be coming, but that is definitely not a spiritual practice. That's one of the kleshas, right? The clinging to life that we all have to varying degrees. But I think it, like, even if we just for the sake of argument said that was possible, that we could stop aging, and you know, there are people who say that that's happening, that that's about to happen. It's not a spiritual practice, right? I mean, if you want to think of, like, what does yoga says that clinging to life comes from ignorance, and everything that's in the material world is temporary and is going to decay. And the real practice of yoga is to recognize the part of us that's not temporary, and to have grace about the body as changing. And I think we cause so much suffering for ourselves that we don't accept aging. I remember when I first started teaching older adults, and there was this woman, she was so cute. And, you know, she was 85. We were walking into class one day, and she always has Beverly Hills. Everybody, you know, is always, like, their makeup always on, their hair's always done. They've got, like, matching outfits. She said, "I'm so ashamed of the way that I've let myself go." And she hadn't let herself go in any way whatsoever. Like, she wasn't overweight. She wasn't, like, any of the ways that people think of, like, letting themselves go. She just was old. You know, she was just 85. And I was so sad for her because she was so sweet, but she had this real depression over the fact that she had gotten old. And I think that happens so much. People say, "I don't know what happened. I don't understand how this happened to me." Like, despite the fact that everyone in the world, if you're lucky, ages, we feel really devastated and ashamed of it. And it's like we're breaking our own hearts about it. And I certainly understand, right? Something happens and you're like, "I'm going to get back to the way it used to be. I'm not going to get old. I'm whatever the thing is that you're clinging to. You know, I'm going to get Botox, and I'm going to get a facelift, and I'm going to get a this lift, and I'm going to, you know," there's a lot of superficial ways that we pretend like we're not aging. I think people very secretly take hormones and don't want to talk about it because it feels, I mean, I have a couple of friends who have a lot of breast cancer in their family who are taking hormones, which feels like a crazy idea to me. I've got breast cancer in my family, and I'm like, yeah, I don't need that heartache for myself. But I think, you know, we can't tell people you shouldn't do this. But I think that we can teach people by our own example of, "I'm going to do everything I can to feel young." But what that means to me is I want to be strong. I want my mind to work. I want my body to work. I want to move in the world. Like, I want to feel as good as I can. And that's really possible without doing anything that feels crazy to me. And we've all got our own lines around that. But I think the more that like Helen Mirren is my role model, you know, I think we need to have role models of people who are older, who are taking care of themselves, but are also not being crazy about trying to be young. It just breaks my heart when people are talking about, "Well, maybe I should get a facelift," because, you know, we're in this industry where we're kind of selling ourselves as youth and beauty, but health and youth and beauty are all kind of co-mingled.
That's so true. And I think a huge part of what you're saying is really coming to light is that's really the message that most often comes through in a yoga class, like, to kind of love this body and this mind where it is right now in this moment.
And know that it is going to change. And, right. You know, it's so interesting because I think there's such a sort of conundrum about love and attachment. I think people really confuse those things. "Well, I'm really attached to my kids," or, you know, "I'm not attached to things," which is, you know, mostly not true. But we know we're supposed to say that as teachers, right? "I'm not attached." I'm like, yeah, just drop your iPhone in the toilet and see how attached you are. But that when we really are able to, I mean, the thing that I am so clear right now, and partly, you know, because I do work with older people, is like, I know my mind isn't as fast as it used to be. And I'm so grateful that it works as well as it does. You know, my body doesn't do everything that it used to do. And that makes me so grateful for what it's able to do. I mean, you know, there's this sort of wake up call of, oh yeah, this too will change. And to embrace what we have and to be really, really grateful for what we have, you know, whether that's just our physical capacity, grateful for this practice that we can do that offers so many other things than, you know, just being strong and flexible. So I think that that's like the gift of aging, I think, really is recognizing how lucky you are and how temporary it is. So, you know, really the full, all eight limbs of yoga become more interesting and really like more support.
When you say the gift of aging, you know, I keep hearing this thread. You said at the beginning when we were talking that people were talking about the symptoms of menopause and you started talking about the positive things. You know, that switches the mindset that this isn't a condition. You know, a student isn't coming to you and they're saying like, I have menopause, and then you're going to fix it for them. Instead, you're really embracing like, what is that like? And the positive as well. Can you tell us some of the things that you've learned on the positive side of things?
And so the positive thing is, like, if I wake up and I'm cranky, it's not because my hormones just spiked, you know? So there's, like, a steadiness mind that you don't get. I mean, you know, for, like, let's see, from 11 to 48, you know, for most of my life, I was on a cycle that went up and went down and went up and went down. And so sometimes you'd be like, wait, is that really something to be upset about? Or is it just that my period's about to start? So there's like a questioning of like, is this real? Is this hormones? And then, you know, when you don't have that fluctuation anymore, there's a clarity that comes with that, even if, you know, maybe your brain isn't working as well as you wish that it did. But there's that. And I think there is this real sense of, wow, my life, if I'm really lucky, is at least halfway over. And there is this sort of sense of, maybe urgency isn't the right word, but that's the word that's coming to me, this sense of, you know, live the life that you want for yourself now. And I think we have those, you know, seminal moments in our lives. And I think that's really one of them of, oh, it's a real wake up call to how temporary your life is. And I think that there is something really freeing about, there's just kind of, I'm not going to take anymore. Sort of like, I'm not a girl. There's sort of owning your womanhood and owning your feminine power that's in a really different way. I mean, I think you spend a lot of time in your younger years sort of wielding your sexual power like a weapon, you know? I think there's just a real shift in the way that you're valued as a woman. And in some ways, there's like a grief of maybe you don't feel as sexy, or maybe you're not even like as drawn to sex. And that's like a whole big subject that's difficult. But there's also, oh, I have a different value. Like, if you were always relying on your youth and beauty, it's kind of time to like look a little deeper and say, oh, I have a different value. I think in this culture, you know, we're so used to, when you're younger, not feeling taken seriously. And I think that there is, you know, if you think of the women that you think of as like strong and making a difference, they're not in their 30s. It's like sort of midlife is the time that women a lot of times own their power.
Right. I kind of feel like I needed someone hanging around me with that message when I was 15. That would have been really good to be like,
yeah.
But in the same hand, maybe you can't see it or be there till you're 50 plus.
I just think when you're 15, you are never going to get old. And that is not going to be, I mean, you know, you just, I think, I mean, when I was 15, I just remember thinking, when I'm old and I'm 30, you know.
Exactly.
And old just keeps getting, you know, 15 years away from wherever you are. And yeah, so, but I do think the messages that we're, you know, younger people are paying attention to what is the model of beauty and what is the model of femininity. And I think that we really do have a responsibility if we don't want 15-year-old girls to feel like, I mean, you know, I have a friend whose 17-year-old daughter just got a boob job, and I'm like, what are we teaching our kids about what it is to be beautiful and what it is to be valued? And I think that we have a real chance to shift that model.
Mm-hmm. I think yoga teachers are right on the front line of that. You know, the majority of our students are women, whether they're teens, like even little kids. Some people are teaching kids yoga, teen yoga, all the way up. Yoga for those who are in menopause or well beyond that. I think we have an amazing opportunity to kind of share that message of, and like you said, live that example.
Right, because you can, I mean, you know, that message is, you know, really murky when, you know, the other message is, if I'm young and beautiful and posting in a bikini, I'm gonna be a lot more popular, and people are gonna love me more. And so, I mean, you know, it's such we're in such an interesting place with social media and also just with the popularization of yoga. And, you know, who doesn't want to be young and beautiful forever? But I also think we can redefine what we think beauty is. And, you know, there's the yoga for everybody. And this is what a yoga body looks like, that is really changing, that you don't have to be young and skinny and all of those things that the sort of original, and it's not even original, it's just sort of the popularized view of yoga is.
Mm-hmm. I really go out of my way to find, you know, Instagram accounts where people are like, I'm just a regular person. I'm not... You're not going to see me posed on a beach with a professional photographer. I'm just doing this yoga here. It's mine.
Yeah. It's, I mean, you know, and those pictures are pretty and those girls are pretty. I mean, you know, but it's sort of like looking at any kind of model anywhere and thinking, oh, that's what I'm supposed to look like, or that's what beauty is supposed to look like. Yeah. And which adds to the shame, which adds to the, I mean, people feel like they've got to be in a certain amount of shape to show up in a class or be able to do a certain amount of poses or whatever, so that they can even be, even in older adults classes, I have people, you know, giving me a long list of, well, I had this thing happen, I had this thing happen. And you know, they're sort of pleading with you to not judge them for showing up the way they are.
Right. You're like, thanks for being here.
Yeah.
Thanks for showing up. Now, you talked about really coming to this place of where you're doing your work. You know, you get to that, if you think 50 is the middle of your life, and you are doing some amazing work. So tell us a little bit about what you're offering now and kind of how yoga teachers can work with you further if they're interested in learning more from you.
And so I just last year led my first 300-hour advanced yoga training, which was amazing. You know, it's so interesting because to teach something over a year, it just felt like, oh, this is really yoga. Like, yeah, over the course of a year, people are going to go through stuff. And so it felt like this, it felt really like we were doing all of the limbs of yoga, because we got to see how it's so helpful to see how everybody goes through stuff. Because, you know, you think it's just you. And especially as a teacher, you feel like I'm supposed to always be positive and my practice should always be consistent. And we, you know, we put so much pressure on ourselves. So teaching that training, and it really inspired me to do longer programs where people really have a chance to absorb the teachings and also cultivate community. And I teach online, which I think is really the, for better or worse, the wave of the future. Worse because it feels like, you know, you don't have that connection of community that we really need, but also to make it accessible for people who, you know, they can't, either they don't have the funds or the time or whatever different things get in the way of actually showing up for classes and for training. So I teach classes and courses online at Yogis Anonymous, which is an online yoga studio. And I teach classes and workshops in LA and all over. So always developing new stuff. I'm in the middle of an offering for an online restorative course, which I'm super excited about. I'm super excited about relaxation.
That's so good. Well, I'm going to put a link to your website for sure for our listeners, and then the Yogis Anonymous as well. I didn't know about that. I love it that you're bringing it online. Also, I hear you on the struggle, but for someone who lives very far away from you, that's kind of the reality, unless I want to hop on a plane and travel there. I also love it that you're teaching it over a year. I took my first yoga teacher training and it was over an entire year. And as much as I'm not very patient, it was a real gift.
You know, it's so funny because I think when you're new, you know, before I did my first teacher training, I did a workshop, like a 5-day workshop with Gary Krasov, and he was talking about his training and it was 2 years. And it was like at 2-week increments in Hawaii. So there were all sorts of, you know, it was like $4,000 and that was 20 years ago. And I mean, for each module, and I was like, yeah, I can't, none of that works for me. but I said to him, 2 years, that's a long time. And he said, it goes fast. And then like 12 years later, I did another, you know, workshop with him, and I just had to laugh at how, as, you know, someone who was interested in doing a teacher training, 2 years felt like a really long time to wait. And then in hindsight, looking back, it's like, because you don't know when you start your training that that's just the first of many. You just want to learn it so that you can be a teacher. And I think, especially when you're newer, you want to do your training. And you have no idea what you're getting into. You have no idea like how overwhelming it is and how much more you're going to need to learn and how much you're going to want to have a community.
Mm-hmm. So true. Thank you so much for bringing light to this topic today, you know, just to so many aspects of it. I have new insights. I'm sure our listeners do. And I'm excited just to hear the conversation that comes out of this episode as well. So thank you.
Thank you. It's great talking to you.
Thank you so much for your time today, Leslie. I feel like I have some more knowledge about what someone might experience with menopause, and I really appreciate that you brought in the discussion of the benefits that you have experienced, that it's not just this condition that we're going to run into. And I find it really interesting, even when I was kind of writing out my show notes, that I kept wanting to write when a woman hits menopause. And instead, I feel like you gave me this awareness that when a woman experiences or enters menopause, even the language around it can be really powerful. So thank you for that. The biggest takeaway for me today was in what I can now say to someone who comes to me at the start of a class and talks to me about menopause. I jotted a few things down like Shitali breath, letting students know that they can leave the room, rest, or do what they need to do anytime during the class. So these are things that, yes, my logical mind could have thought about, but I feel like now I've got them in my tool belt ready to go. For those of you who have or are experiencing menopause, I would love to hear from you. I'd love to know how yoga helps you, what works for you. Share your thoughts in the comments of this episode. So that's at theconnectedyogateacher.com/56. I also love this awareness that Leslie brought to us today when she said that she really realized that she was halfway in life at this magical age of 50. And her quote was, "Live the life that you want for yourself now." So for our connected yoga teacher listeners who are 50 and over, I would love to hear what that experience is like as well. Men and women, just kind of how does that feel to be at this, if we thought of a halfway point in life? Thank you to Nano Yoga from Japan for leaving a review, and it was the best podcast for yoga teachers, so thank you so much. Nano Yoga wrote, "I really appreciate this podcast. As a newbie teacher, the fear to do this all by myself is real, but this really has the most helpful content. Thank you for creating this." Well, thank you, Nano Yoga from Japan, for leaving the review. For those of you who have not yet left a review, please do so using the button in our show notes. It's super easy. You just click on the button and it shows up in iTunes. We have some pretty awesome episodes coming up. And because you listened all the way to the end today, I want to tell you some of the topics that we're looking at. Next week, we're for sure going to hear feng shui your yoga space. So I'm really excited that you get to hear from Marina on this amazing topic. I'm also going to talk a little bit in future episodes about building resiliency, confidence, and self-promotion, how to market your yoga teacher training. We're going to hear hear about the Accessible Yoga Conference and how we can make yoga more accessible for our students. We're going to also dive into yoga teacher saturation, what it's like to be a full-time yoga teacher, and we're going to hear from a huge survey that was done on full-time yoga teachers. Also, the Buteyko breath and yoga for seniors, how to approach a new yoga studio. So I feel like it's spring and we've got lots of things planted and ready to sprout for you. Take care, connected yoga teachers. Stay connected to self, to your practice, and to your community. Namaste.